So how would you feel if your identity, who you felt you were as a person, was denied time and time again? What if it was at a national level? All right, that's what my guest today goes through on a daily basis, because there's a narrative about her that isn't really about her. Luckily, she's a fierce person who will fight to be seen and heard for who she is. However, the way that this happens to her tells us a lot about how we as a community in Australia see women, see survivors of child sexual abuse and sexual abuse, and how little we hold our media to account. Grace Tame is an Australian of the Year, an author, and a voice that's truly shaking the foundations of our society. She gained prominence for her advocacy and determination to overturn some antiquated laws in Tasmania that prevented survivors from speaking out about their experiences of childhood sexual abuse through the Let Her Speak campaign. Because until April 6, 2020, it was illegal for victims to identify themselves as the victim of such a crime. If they did speak out about what happened to them, they could have faced 6 months in prison. Now, the law was probably brought in to protect young people, vulnerable people, from being publicly identified. However, if those survivors chose themselves to share their stories, it would have been illegal to do so. And that forced anonymity only reinforces the stigma and the shame in the community about the victims of such crimes. And meanwhile, the laws that were supposed to protect these kids ended up protecting the people who committed the crimes. The same laws that used the word relationship when it came to defining these crimes. The crime was, and this is a quote, to maintain a sexual relationship with a person under 17. Now, you can clearly hear how that particular word, relationship, changes how you think about what actually happens between a victim who's a child and the perpetrator who is an adult. It's most definitely not a relationship at all, but it instantly changes the mindset. Now, in a world where conversations about consent and survivor support are more crucial than ever, Grace Tame is a driving force in raising awareness and demanding change. She has courage, she has determination, and those things have really paved the way for important discussions that truly challenge the status quo. But as we're finding out, our status quo really does not like to be challenged. The absolutely rancid stacks on that Grace has had to deal with as an adult is utterly shameful. The things she has had to endure for speaking out about her abuse is just too awful to behold. And these things continue to happen. These things that happened to her have all been perpetrated by men, adult men. Grace Tame is a powerful, brilliant person, and I'm so glad you're going to get a chance to engage with her today. Thanks for coming. It's extraordinary to speak to you, because I went to an all-boys school. I'm one of four boys. I had a very, very strange view of women and women's role in society. I grew up in Queensland. I was at the school of the landed gentry and their doctors and lawyers. My parents were the doctors. And I never saw another point of view. I didn't understand. I didn't know. I just didn't have any idea. It's pre-internet. It's not to, you know, I just didn't know. As I got older and as I got out into the workforce, through some very kind conversations and through a very patient girlfriend I had when I was 21, I kind of started to figure things out. And it was a hard road, because I had believed many different things as a young man. We talk about legislation, but it's so fucking molasses-like slow. At what point do these conversations need to happen, Grace? They're pretty early, aren't they?
I mean, it depends what conversations.
Around respect, around agency, around seeing humanity in others.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, I mean, I've never, with respect to the fact that I've never raised a child, and I parents are going to raise their children differently.
Yeah.
And I think it's hard to know, but then at the same time, I've been lucky in that both my parents, for all of their differences from each other and from me, they instilled in me a profoundly immovable humanity. I mean, I come from two very open-minded individuals who are very also community-minded at the same time as being, you know, independent thinkers. You know, I'm just thinking about my childhood as a, you know, albeit pretty turbulent frame of reference. There weren't any, like, direct conversations really that I can think of. It was sort of demonstrated to me.
Yeah, the kids don't do what you tell them, they do what you show them. That's the worst and best thing about parenting.
Exactly. I mean, my parents sort of led by example. I mean, my father was a teacher. He was a public high school teacher. He retired as a teacher of higher needs kids, kids who were both had varying disabilities, whether they were learning disabilities or they were kids who came from backgrounds that were difficult and they're, you know, I remember my dad would have to go and pick up some kids from their houses, you know, and they'd be like sometimes asleep in their clothes and he would have to get them up and stuff like that.
To get them to school.
Yeah. Right. Like, but he...
Oh, wow. So he really cared. He really, really cared.
Oh, yeah. But I mean, like, there are a lot of teachers that do that. And, you know, like, they are the lifeblood of our community. Teachers play many roles in a lot of ways. And my mum just retired. She was a youth worker for 3 years, and she was in that role caring for wards of the state whose parents had relinquished their responsibility of parenting.
So you were raised by two people who just had, like, empathy and thinking of others as the core of their values, and that they found a job that is, because that's not a job. You don't do those jobs for the cash. They're not, you know.
No, they're not big earning jobs.
No. You've got to love that. You've got to need to do it.
I mean, my mum had lots of different jobs. She was a croupier at one point, blackjack dealer. She worked in health insurance at one point. She worked in hotels at one point. She was a newsreader for about 10 years, but that was just at, you know, like Wind Television. She actually earned less than my dad did as a public high school teacher. That shows you Tasmania's television industry. she worked in youth work, and that is like a tough gig. And, you know, in terms of children who have had it tough, but I was like, I'm really lucky in that they never imposed any kind of ideological thinking on me, and in terms of respectful behaviours, and again, nobody is perfect, and they're both flawed individuals like everybody else, and certainly I fall into that basket. It is really hard because, like, even the day, like, I'm 28 years old, and I think about how different my childhood was to now, and the way that, like, technology is so infused in learning, even and in play, and it's almost like the role that a parent plays is minimized. Like, it's not the way I see it. Like, it's just different. It's been changed by things like that.
In some ways, other ways, it's far more hands on. In other ways, there's a real pressure to be like it was. All right, out of bed, be home when the streetlights come on. That was what I grew up with, you know, and it wasn't on the parent to look after you all day. You had to find something to do, and that was it, and we were fine.
But I guess, do you know what I'm saying? Like, as in, like, how I would describe it is there has been, you know, over the last century, and this comes from my knowledge of history, there has been this steady individualization of society, this atomization of society, and this destruction of the family unit, this destruction of the community unit, and that is what has produced this, you know, individualization. And so people are, you know, spending more time at work, they're needing to spend more time at work to earn more money at the level of the individual in terms of friendships. For people who don't necessarily have children, I know that society has been re-engineered.
Oh, yeah.
So it is. It's really hard to talk about respectful relationships, because relationships in general have changed.
Without a doubt. And people's place in their wider community is so different to what it's different from what it was a year ago. It's different from what it was 5 years ago. And as you meant, the fracturing and the atomization, the granularity of, you know, you are the logo you wear on your T-shirt. That's how we know you're awesome. You are the amount of followers you got on TikTok. That's how we know you're awesome. Not you. We heard that you helped that person the other day, and that's nice you did that, you know. And that's a lasting happiness when someone, you know, because you help that person because they're in your community, versus, you know, not knowing who you are in your community. This is the best street I've ever lived on. I know all of my neighbours. I have their phone numbers. Good. They're delightful. Wolf goes and runs around and plays. It's the fucking best ever. I've never lived in a street like this. And I miss it, because it's something that reminded me of when I was younger. But there's people that live in gigantic, you know, huge tracts, suburbs, you just go forever. And there's no, you can't, they're not pedestrian neighborhoods. You can't walk anywhere. When I lived in America for 10 years, we had that in common. I would never see anybody. I would see my neighbor's gardener. That's the only person in my street. I lived in a house for a year and a half. People just don't see each other. And when you don't see each other, we're afraid of each other.
And it's disconnected. And that's the whole point of life, is to foster connection. And the connection is, it's this mass spiritual death that is permeating society at large.
And a health death. Loneliness is as dangerous as smoking a pack of cigarettes a day.
Yeah.
Well, what I used to sit on the board at Sane Australia when that one came up. I was like, fucking hell. We've got to get community theatre group. I don't know what it is. Like, let's get people out the door.
Yeah.
We've got to queue 2.5 years and don't leave your house. But putting these practices into your day, because I know what it's like. I was agoraphobic for a while, and I did not leave the house for days at a time. Mental health was very poor, and it felt good to not want to leave the house. Because, I'm safe. Don't have to look at fucking people, you know. Don't have to talk to people. It would be the worst thing in the world. It was terrifying. If anyone speaks to me, it'll be the worst. I'm terrified. It was bad. And to allay that fear, I would stay in the house more. And then I'm like, fuck, I've really got to go, because, you know, Australian Idol's on tonight. I'm going to have to go to work. Go to work and do that. Run home. Drink bottles of wine. And that's, you know, it's a terrible loop that you can get stuck in. And then all you need to do is like throw a couple of seeds of fear or othering or misinformation or anti-Semitism or racism or misogyny and that. And it's a fucking tinderbox, man.
Yeah. And sometimes it's not actually that you're agoraphobic necessarily, or maybe it manifested into that. But what I think a lot of the time, and I could be wrong, this is just an idea, a lot of the time what we really struggle with as human beings, certainly because we tend to overcomplicate things, or we tend to overlook the simple because we are cognitive misers, is that we fail to identify what it is that is the feeling that we're feeling, you know. And like in your case, you as somebody who is like presenting on television, which is in of itself, like that's so much pressure, you know. It's probably too much pressure in a lot of cases for, you know, the average person. And so like you were just countering that with the opposite of like, I need to repair myself.
Well, the thing I must explain to you is like to go to work like that, it's an extraordinarily structured environment. There's a hierarchy.
So controlled.
I know exactly. It's live television. I know what's going to happen next. I get to say what happens next. I know everything that's about to happen. I'm in complete control. I'm part of a system that is going to start here. It's going to end there. That's what's going to happen. It's going to be great. And then I get to go home. And so it's very different to being on a train or walking down the street to get my groceries. And the other thing is because it is so intense because of the – I since identified this through the help of very clever psychiatrists. Because it is so intense, there's no room for the shitty thinking to get in because I'm just – it's like when I do Masked Singer, right? There's 14, 12 cameras in the studio and it's like, okay, we're rolling everybody, 10, 9, 8. Okay, so 8 steps forward, left point, right point. Don't stand there, right there, because that's when the fireworks are going to explode. Don't catch on fire. Can't see anything because I'm in a mask. Flip the microphone, catch it without looking, take the mask off, hand it to that dancer. Don't stand there because there's fireworks, but then be over there and then look here, look there, blah, 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 blah. Complete fucking peace. There's no weird thoughts. There's no nothing. There's nothing. It's just complete serenity. It's incredible.
Yeah, but I think that what perhaps produces that in serenity is, and I could be wrong, but in order to produce that serenity is, it's maybe partially, adrenaline has a codifying effect on memory. So, So what's codifying that crystal clear?
Yeah.
Like what's giving you that crystal clear?
I'm not jacked at those point. I don't have adrenaline in those moments.
What, do you not have adrenaline?
I don't. I'm very aware. As someone who's lived with paranoid delusions, actual psychosis, I know what it feels like when I can feel my adrenaline spasm halfway up my back and send that fury up my spine.
But also that's like you're neurodivergent, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so neurodivergent people have different pain receptors.
Oh, right, yeah.
So different, they process pain differently. That's why you tend to find them in places like this where they're able to, like they've got really high pain thresholds and really high, really, really.
You mentioned that.
Yeah, really high. I'm like.
It's a long story about that.
I could be wrong. I'm not.
We find our place. Well, let me ask you this. What do you get out of when it's you and a canvas or you and a sketch pad? What do you get out of that? Because you're an artist. You create. You're in that moment. What do you get out of those moments? What are they like for you?
I mean, I completely am just not in a different world, but I'm completely transfixed by the task at hand, and I'm connecting with that project, such that everything else around me falls away, and then it almost takes me a while to get out of it. Like if I go to the bathroom, I'll get up and then like run into a door or a wall or something because I've lost my depth perception.
Wow.
I'm like I resituate myself according to what I'm doing there. And I get out of my head.
Yeah, right.
And I think it's really powerful release of trauma. Sometimes I'll put on music, other times I won't. You know, I think there's a meditative aspect to it, even though it's, you're occupied. The same with running or riding. I really like to be out in nature.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's a very mindful thing, particularly if you're – we're not talking about a colouring in book here. We're talking about, you know, very nuanced application of shade and colour and light because the smallest anomaly will – because you're very photorealistic in some of your work, the smallest anomaly will just change how somebody views it. You have to be very, very careful. So you are in the moment. You have no choice but to be and accessing that state. I recognize what you're speaking about. It's delightful to be in that space. what do you feel like when you look at a thing and go, yep, that's how I saw it in my head? What's that feel like?
I'm a bit like David Lynch in that I think he said something about, like, I don't interpret my work.
Yeah.
Why should you?
Hey, he's too good. I love him so much.
No, I don't like, and he's a bit.
Why don't interpret my work?
Wow.
Why should you?
Wow, that's.
Yeah. Man, Lynchy boy.
I wish I could do a Harry Dean Stanton impression, but I would need to smoke like 80 packs of cigarettes.
You cannot choose a life of advocacy, but you have. And it comes with a lot of, it comes with, when you decide that this is important enough to fight for, you go into that knowing that there's going to be, for some bizarre reason, people that fight back. How do you keep yourself healthy when you're in this turbulent world of advocacy, particularly in the area that you're in?
To be clear about what I chose and what I didn't choose,
yeah.
We've got to sort of rewind to 2017.
Yeah.
When I was approached, well, actually first my mother was approached by the journalist Nina Fennell. My mother was at the University of Tasmania studying behavioural science. And the reason that she was approached by Nina Fennell, who's a journalist, and she does a lot of work reporting on sexual assaults, particularly that occur on university campuses. Mm-hmm. She's done some great campaigns. She created the hashtag Let Her Speak campaign and runs the hashtag Let Her Speak and hashtag Let Us Speak campaigns. She approached my mother because there was a lot of unrest on the campus. The child sex offender, the twice convicted child sex offender who abused me, was also studying there and had actually committed a second crime while he was studying there. Shortly after he was released from prison for the first offences, the abuse of me, but also of possession of child abuse material. Shortly after he was released from prison, he was almost immediately awarded a federally funded PhD scholarship to study chemistry and put into student accommodation with undergraduate students that had shared shower facilities. You know, it's not so much that he was just studying there. While he was studying there, a number of people allegedly complained about his presence on campus and at the university facilities like the gym, where even by his own admission in an interview with Bettina Arndt that was published in 2017, you know, he'd be up on the equipment for up to 5 hours at a time. And people were uncomfortable with his presence because he is quite a domineering man, shameless. And there were students who had been at my high school who were there, you know, and my mother was also there. And really, it was the second offence, I think, that was the issue, because he, as my mother pointed out, must have broken the student code of conduct by committing the second crime. He boasted online about his offences against me. He said, you know, judging by all the emails and tweets I've received, I must be one of the most envied, or most of the men in Australia envy me, or words to that effect.
Boy.
And he did. He served a second prison term. And, you know, long story short, Nina Fennell reached out to my mother first. And then, of course, there was the reality that there was a second person behind this, because he was a child sex offender and I was the child, now an adult at 22 years old at this point, behind that narrative. And she was interested in telling that story. And we communicated, I shared my story, and it was actually my mother that pointed out that there would be this prohibitive law. And Nina was horrified. She spoke to news.com's or News Corporation's senior legal counsel, Gina McWilliams, who confirmed that there was indeed a prohibitive law and pointed out exactly what it was to her. And that was the sort of the birth of the Let Her Speak campaign, essentially, and other survivors came on board, two down in Tasmania at first. And the first time that I showed my face on television in August 2019, after I got a court order, before the law was actually changed in Tasmania in 2020, that was very different, you know, that level of advocacy, that level of a profile was very different. You know, I knew Steve Fisher, who was the first Tasmanian survivor to win a right to speak, who did that back in 2001, 22 years ago. And yeah, it was very different as I understood it. And it was pretty rough too. Like after that episode of television, a few weeks after that episode of television, I was actually in a car chase. I was chased home by a thug who chased me all the way home to my mother's house. I remember the police coming over, and because my stepdad and my mum had seen that, they saw the car drove off. But yeah, a thug got out of his car while I was still in it was my mum's car that I was driving at the time, and bashed on the window while I was still inside of it and called me a fucking whore. And there were sort of like pretty horrific messages on the YouTube video of the episode of the 7:30 report that I'd done. And yeah, it was a very different sort of experience, I suppose, to being named Australian of the Year, which is something that I didn't have any control over at all. I didn't have any control over that process. You know, the awards process is still something that I don't understand. I don't know who selects it. I know some of the people, you know, I met them eventually when Max and I went to Canberra in January 2021. But that's something that nobody can prepare for, especially because there's no real control over the public reaction to it. So that's something that I've had to learn
quickly
through a trial by fire.
I
think certainly the experiences that I've had just in my life, one of those I just described to you,
it was fucking terrible, mate.
Put me in good stead, because that's the underbelly that I went in with. Like, on the one hand, it's different, but it's also like, I think that's the stuff that people don't see of what, you know, child sexual abuse is like.
Jesus Christ, man.
And there's, you know, that's not the only time. I mean, and I, before we went to Canberra in 2021, we had someone come over and go through our bins. They tipped all the contents of our bin, like glassware that had been smashed. It was our recycling bin was taken. You know, that sort of stuff. It's cage rattling stuff. It's designed to make you fearful. It's intimidating. Yeah. It sort of has that message of like, what's next? Are they going to take it a step further? We've had people come and bash on the fly screen door. We've had people bash on the front door of our current house. It's to send that message of, you know, we know where you live.
What makes you keep showing up?
Well, children are far more important. And like, what are you going to do? Like, what are you going to do? You can take note of it. You can document the time, the nature of it. Keep a running, you know, tally of these things. You can report them. But
how do you keep yourself okay, knowing that stuff could happen?
I mean, I talk about it. I speak to friends about it. I know other people who have been doing this work for a lot longer than I have, and they have experienced similar things as well. Some of them have experienced far worse incarnations of this technique, as I described, as like cage rattling sort of stuff. This surveillance, if you want to describe it like that, you know, being like maybe followed. You might, and some of it's like, it's all sort of walking along this sort of like alongside the law, and you know, where you can't necessarily prove it. You can take sort of photos of it. You know, you might see a car in your street and you think, is that car like, you know, and then you start to see other things, and it's to plant that seed of doubt in your mind to make you anxious. And you can be vigilant, but there's also a danger in getting too carried away, because then you just spend every day of your life going like looking over your shoulder. So and that's sort of the intention of that behaviour as well, is to make people live in a constant state of fear, to be, you know, living in psychological purgatory, to be a prisoner in one's own mind. And that's no way to live, is it?
Well, I can definitely relate. what do you do through the day to make
not
sure
that.
No, but like how do you what are some things that you can do to make sure that you've got resilience to deal with this kind of shit?
Well, draw pictures, go for a run, like yeah. ride a bike, you know, talk to your friends, like simple medicine that is really not that far-fetched. Eat whole foods, drink water, sleep, you know. Keeping your communication lines open, and I don't mean like being on the phone,
yeah.
You know, scrolling through the internet. I mean real authentic lines of communication, mm-hmm. like seeing your friends and trying to live as wholesome a life as possible. Community is really good, being with big groups of friends and just like again, sharing your stuff, this stuff, like making it, putting it out in the open and like this stuff is like it's the Wizard of Oz behind the curtain. It's real. It's physically real.
Mm.
But what it means psychologically when you break it down is actually like, I'm like, well, what are you trying to tell me? Because I actually don't believe in it. Like I don't believe in your narrative.
Right.
Like, because there's also, they want me to believe it's scary, but I think, well, actually I'm going to flip the narrative and go, well, actually I think you're being silly. Like, I think it's laughable.
Mm.
I think you're being funny and sad.
Like,
you know, it's really, there's a lot of power in that. Like,
yeah.
You know, like, okay.
Oh, man. Fucking hell, man.
Like, okay, you're just, it's just a car. Like, it's just a car and a big angry thug bashing on the window, calling me a fucking whore. Like, it was scary at the time, you know, because we were going like 90 Ks an hour in a residential street at one point.
Christ.
And maybe if I took a, like, if I wasn't a great driver and like I really, like it shook me and I took a wrong turn or something like that, like it can happen like that. But.
So this kind of leads me to one thing I did want to ask you about. I've seen you talk about this. I've read that you've spoken about rage as a fuel.
Yeah. And
is that a good fuel source to have? Is it a handy fuel source? Because like things like rage and anger where I'm very reluctant. Audrey's sometimes just like, just get fucking angry about something. I'm like, I'm sober now. Like there was a time in my life where I wasn't.
Yeah, I'm sober too.
All right. Yeah, I'm 13 years now. But there was a time in my life when anger, if it got to a point, would take the reins and point me in directions and start to say and do things that I would then later on go, who the fuck was I when that happened? I'm still me, but it would take over. And so I'm reluctant to allow myself to feel that amount of upset, probably to my detriment. So that's what I'm asking. Like when it comes to something like anger or rage as fuel, what's the way that you can access that in a safe way?
I think very rarely. Yeah. I think it's very rare circumstances, and I think perhaps I might have been taken out of context when I was speaking about that.
Okay.
I was a child when I got very angry at the man who abused me.
And rightly so.
Yeah, and
well, you have less nuanced emotions when you're young.
Yeah.
You only get the 16 crayons, and then later on you get the big set.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
all you got.
And I like so the context in which I spoke about that. There was an article that was written, I think, just after I wrote my book, and it was a promotional piece.
Right.
It was in the Sydney Morning Herald, and I said, like, rage saved my life in the end.
Yeah.
Which, again, you know, it was playing into I'm sad about that because it was playing into a trope that was used by the media. The media often recycle images of me that were taken from one speech. The day that I was at the press club in 2022
with Brittany Higgins,
when I had broken my collarbone 9 days earlier, and I don't think people absorb that. I had perhaps good reason to be frustrated then as well, because I had been told on a phone call.
The phone call. I read about
I'd been
that.
Told on a phone call, and not just, you know, don't say anything about the Prime Minister, but I'd also been told, and Max was there as well, he remembers this. I'd been told, you know, in August 2021, like only 5 months, or not, no, sorry, 7 months after, I'd been named Australian of the Year, that, yeah, like, you know, you were setting up a foundation and like we've got a lot of resources and we could support your foundation or we could not support your foundation. It was yuck, really.
It was the phone call version of the car chase.
Well, it was just
phone,
like
the phone call of the tipping the bins upside down. It's the same fucking shit.
It was, and the point that I was trying to make was like, what did I do this for? Like, why did you guys, you know, like, I was like, all right, okay. And so, yeah, I was, I mean, disappointed is not a powerful enough word. Mm. I was in a sling. Mm. I was using, at that point, cycling to cope because in 2021 I also fractured my pelvis in two places. And then at the end of that year I also fractured my foot and then I snapped my collarbone. And I was doing those things. I was running, you know, when I was named Australian of the Year, I was running 110 kilometres away and I weighed 46, 47 kilos maybe. I was really struggling. I wasn't menstruating. I hadn't menstruated for about two years. I was anorexic, and again, like, I've gone through phases of anorexia, which is it didn't begin as a result of the trauma. You know, I had other traumas in my childhood. It wasn't actually the first time that I was sexually abused, but it certainly worsened and was connected to the abuse at my high school, because he sort of wove all kinds of psychological manipulation into that experience. And so, yeah, it was, there was like the media have sort of recycled those pictures of me without the sort of the what should be quite an obvious context that I was in like a lot of physical pain.
Yeah.
You know, to give a speech like that to the press gallery, one doesn't really want to take endone because you might be a bit cooked. And
you don't want to be slurring your words. And
so,
you don't wanna, yeah.
And when I first broke my collarbone, and it's like you can see this big lump there. I didn't have surgery on it, but it was when I first broke it, the bone was not displaced, so it was still sort of connected by a hairline. And then what happened, they just sent me home from the emergency department in this sling, and they sent me home with some painkillers and a script for some endone, like 7 days worth. And they were like, oh, you know, you'll get a call from the orthopedic surgeon. They couldn't have an orthopedic surgeon see me then because they were too overloaded, strain from COVID. The healthcare system is under is, you know, speaks for itself. And so I didn't hear from anyone. And then over the like preceding 10 days or so, I could just feel this ripping sensation. Like, it was like there were, like, you know, ropes that were on fire that were just being pulled inside my chest just constantly. And then when we returned from Canberra, I went back to the emergency department and I said, look, I have no medical experience whatsoever. Yeah. I've only been to a community college for 2 years. That's the highest level of education that I've got. But I reckon there's something wrong. So I went in, got a scan. And again, like, don't have any medical experience, but I have two perfectly, well, actually, I don't have 20/20 vision, but I've got eyeballs.
Yeah.
And I could see my bone had broken inside of my chest.
Oh, God.
So it had broken slowly inside of my chest.
So you said those are the pictures that they use all the time.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah,
so they were
yeah.
using pictures of my bone breaking inside my chest as like, geez, they're so angry. And I'm like, no, I'm just in excruciating pain.
Fucking hell.
And then the context in which that headline came out after my book where I've said rage saved my life in the end is from an anecdote. It's a true moment where I was in the office of this twice convicted sex offender and I'm yelling at him mere days before I reported him to the school who we, you know, later found out had knowledge of what he'd done before. Anyway, so I'm yelling at him and I was telling him that I hated him for what he had done to me. I was crying and he was just sitting there like you are now in his desk chair and he was just like blank stare.
Jesus Christ.
And that is the rage that helped me, who didn't have a concept of psychopathy, didn't know that term really, didn't know what sadism was, didn't understand that term. But I felt that. Mm. I felt the sadism and I felt the psychopathy, because what I could, again, not express in words, but could translate in my child mind, conceptualize in my child imagination, which was very real, was an absence of emotion and an absence of care.
Everything that you've just said, the last like 10 minutes or so of answering back to me, is like, I'm just so fucking, like, that's something that's never going to happen in mainstream, you know, in an article like that, you know, because you've been able to speak and put both those things into context, the picture and the words, in a way that's never going to get described, because it's just never going to happen. And just thank you for doing that. Thank you for, because that story alone is going to change the way people look at news. That story alone is going to change the way people look at a headline, because they might go, oh, hang on a sec, I heard Grace talk about it. I know the picture and I know the headline. The fuck, man, there's so much other shit going on that I never get told about because it doesn't fit in the fucking thing.
It can't fit. And they say a picture paints 1,000 words. And I'm like, but 1,000 words is not enough, is it?
No, no, mate. Tell me about the foundation. I mean, it's like, you know, I'm not going to say it's like, I can't compare things, Ginsburg. Like, with something like this, the problem is so vast and it's so multifaceted. Like, where do you start? Where do you begin? With something like the foundation that you're working with, like, what's it like to work with people and bring people together to focus on this?
It's incredibly rewarding. And the answer to your question about where do you start with something so vast is the same answer, doesn't matter what the problem is, it's somewhere small, because there's a danger in biting off more than you can chew, and also other problems will reveal themselves in due course, and you know, momentum is what you will gain when you achieve little tasks, and you know, you'll get also more, you'll hone your skills from achieving little wins.
What's it like to assemble a team?
Well, you don't need to have a big team of champions. You just need to have a small champion team.
Yes, coach.
Yep.
But you're right. But it must feel good to go, that person.
Yeah, it's important that you have a good skills matrix within your team.
Yeah.
And we have pretty clear goals. You know, within our sort of remit, we've got, you know, three main pillars. There's preventing, intervening and responding to child sexual abuse. And within that sort of more broad goal, if you will, there are three main ways that we approach that. The first is through structural reform, so legal and policy reform. And then there's education and awareness raising, so social reform. And then there's support of survivors, mainly through philanthropy. So we provide the funding for the legal work of survivors of child sexual abuse.
That's extraordinary. Is there anything on the horizon around reporting standards for these cases that could possibly be put to me? Here's the kit. She's like, so like
yeah,
what we did.
We just put them out.
Of course you did. Fantastic.
Yeah. So the National Office of Child Safety worked with the University of Canberra and a number of other stakeholders, Blue Knot, and we worked on it as well. And then also a lot of survivors contributed to it, and other academics and experts in the field. Yeah. And the problem is, though, as I see it, one of many, the real problem is that there's no adequate system of accountability, and this sort of cycles back to what you said at the start. Like, there's as something, but how do you enforce it?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, but it changes. The language of which you tell the story changes the lens through which people view it.
And, exactly. You
know, we spoke like your... your legacy is that, like, the word relationship is the fucking the wrongest word ever to be used in these contexts. But, like, that word itself changes the entire context in which you view something like this. So, and I think about it particularly through my experience of, reporting on suicides, and that there's the clear research in these words. Okay, these words, terribly bad for everyone. You don't think it's benign. It's not. It's really dangerous. It's super easy. You can tell the same story. Here's some different words. That is... That changes the way that people reading may not be aware of these guidelines, but it changes the way they appreciate the story, and it changes the way that they view their community. It changes the way that they view victims and perpetrators in the community, and it's really, really, really important because the language is vital to get right. I'm so happy you did that. It's freaking cool.
Thank you. Yeah, and we still have work to do on that particular issue because we've achieved harmonisation in terms of removing the word relationship from the offence heading. Mm. But there are other parts of the offence. So there's the description of the offence, like the key elements of the offence underneath the heading. So like the charge is called something, and then, there's what it actually entails.
Mm.
And it's in that detail that we encounter some problems because some jurisdictions still have the word relationship in other parts of their offence, and what we want to do is completely expunge that word.
God, you must know some fucking sniper-level lawyers. Because I know your role with human rights lawyers. There's few people that I find more fascinating than human rights lawyers because they're like, oh, no, I'm going to go and I am a person with a keyboard and I'm going to change a government. And that's fucking amazing shit. It's amazing stuff. You mentioned earlier that you were using riding and you were using running as a way to keep yourself together.
Paper mache.
I was actually about your age when I discovered that
pipe cleaners.
Running. I was about your age when I discovered running was very good at helping me regulate my mental health and regulate my mood. Do you still ride?
Yeah. I ran 6Ks on Monday morning. Yeah. I ran the Malabar Headland.
Oh, it's delightful.
It was beautiful.
Clip tops.
Nessa Turnbull Roberts and Moz.
Amazing.
Yeah. Mustafa.
Tell me about, you mentioned earlier that when you're working on an artwork, you have this kind of almost meditative space. What's it like when you're running?
It's also a moving meditation. Yeah, especially if I'm running on the trails and away from the city where I feel frustrated by the constant stopping at traffic lights.
Yeah, it's the worst.
Yeah.
Exactly. How far do you have to run before that kicks in?
Oh, not very far.
No?
I'd say probably maybe a K or so.
Is that all?
Yeah.
Man, I used to have to go for like 40 minutes before that shit would stop in my
brain. Really?
Yeah, I'd have to go for ages.
Yeah.
I ended up running a long ways.
Yeah, well, no, I mean, I do feel that. Like I think – really about the 6K mark is when I get a really good, but yeah, I do like, as soon as I get into a repetitive, it's the repetitive movement for me that helps get me into gear. Yeah. And certainly that's, there's research around like autism and like repetitive movement being like really soothing and stuff like that. So I thought
it was almost like it. The EMDR stuff I used to do with a psychologist a long time ago when they wave the fingers in front of your eyes. Did you ever have that one? Oh, it's wild.
I didn't take very well to EMDR. They gave me a buzzer. I was in the US and I got given a buzzer and I lasted like 2 seconds. I just didn't vibe on it. I was holding a buzzer. And I think it's an autism thing where certain sensations. Things I just don't vibe on.
Wow.
And I just was like, I don't know.
I would find running, I miss it so much. There's research about just moving your body forward through space.
Yeah.
Is fucking good for you.
And I really like yoga too.
Oh, yeah. That's the stuff. And that's really important. But it sounds like you've got a fairly robust structure of things that help you do what you do because you are facing the flamethrower, mate, by the sounds of things, every day.
Yeah. I mean, I think we've all got our challenges. I think
yours are pretty, you described a couple that are pretty humongous, mate.
I don't have any other frame of reference though, really. I think you just face every day and you go, what's next? Like, I try to keep a positive attitude. Some days, obviously, I think we all have a right to go, I feel a bit crap today. For whatever reason. Okay. Yeah. Like, I think, you know, I'm not in a war zone. I was asked the other day about sort of my experience with the media, and I said, and this is my experience again, but I answered by giving sort of just an objective, like, reflection as somebody who takes everything that's in the media with a grain of salt. Mm. And again, with respect to the fact that the proliferation of media does have an effect on people. I did leave Australia not because of the media, but because of I was living in a hometown, hometown, all those sorts of things.
I get it.
But anyway,
I went to another country, changed my name. It was fucking awesome. It was fucking. They were who I showed up to be. That's who they treated me as. It was fucking the best.
But I said in response to this question about the Australian media landscape that. The news landscape is not synonymous with truth. The news and truth are not the same thing. The especially mainstream media, it's a corporate-sponsored circus performance, and occasionally truth gets thrown into that ring and juggled.
That's perfect.
You know,
it couldn't be a more perfect description.
That's what it is.
For the product that is news.
Yeah.
Because it is a product. It is a product that people pay for. Like you know, those glasses, like this microphone. Yeah. People buy it.
Yeah.
And want to sell it.
Exactly. And it gets infused with all different agendas. You know, sometimes it gets chewed up by the lion in the lion's cage. Sometimes it, like, makes it into the ring of fire in there. Sometimes, like, it's just...
There's always a fucking clown car, Grace.
There's always a clown car in there. And that clown car is driven by Rupert Murdoch.
It's perfect. Knowing that and having news literacy is super important. But that's... Just even the way, you know, in this conversation, and I hope I've done an okay job, because I found myself asking you a question and I was like, fuck, have I blown it? I felt like about three times, like, fuck, have I fucking blown it with you, Grace?
No.
I'm really sorry if I've done that. I really am. I was really excited about you coming, and I don't want to have, you know, done the wrong thing by you today. I can very
this
clearly
is a,
see
this
that.
Is a wide. There's a wide gulf between this and bashing on the window of my car and calling it's me a true. Fucking whore. I'm actually a very difficult person to rattle.
I don't doubt that, but I can clearly see how who you are in front of me, and the representation of you, the hyper real version of Grace Tame that we see, represented to us through the lenses of the news product circus user. They're two different things.
But that's a pantomime as well. So everyone in the public eye in the media, and this includes you though, you are given you're pre-cast in a role in the pantomime of Australia's Grand Theatre. You know, and like, you know, for example, just like pick somebody that is known. Like, I wouldn't call myself a celebrity. I'm just known because I'm an advocate. I'm too busy. I'm over here. And occasionally they'll throw me up and they'll go, la, 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 la. You don't have to dance for them. You don't have to play for them. Mm. And for a while, though, as well, I was annoying them because I was, like, I didn't fit into their, like, cookie cutter thing. And they were like, what? Like, she made a meme. She made what?
You look really good on that $5 note, by the way.
Like, oh, not a meme, but you know, like, no, I know like, what like, saying. Oh, like, yeah. She can laugh at herself being in the bong photo, like, you know, and they're like, but she's supposed to be, mad, you know, like, it's just like, because people are people, but they just want somebody to be, you know, whether they want somebody to be, you know, angry, shouty, or Joan of Arc. Or whatever it is, you know, like what they want you to be is their simple thing
We want to get the drive-through. We want to get the thing on the menu and look in the bag and go, close enough.
Yeah, for their cartoon narrative.
They are. And that's the wildest thing.
Because nuance doesn't sell. Banality doesn't sell. But reality is banality. Evil actually is banality.
Mm.
Like the stuff that happened to me was like at times, and it was chilling because it was so cold. Like, you know, it wasn't 100 degrees like the, like, you know, it was awful because it was so protracted.
It doesn't make good horror movie stuff.
You know, it was so, it does. It was so protracted, you know, like how do you write every detail of the time that I was left in an office by this man from the middle of the day until he decided to come back at 9 o'clock at night and I didn't know when he was going to come back? How do you write every detail of how cold that felt and how chilling that felt? How do you write about that?
Certainly not in a way that you can, you know, be sure that you can get out to the sport and the weather by 7:04.
No, like you just, like there's, it's, but like all of that stuff is just, you know.
Yeah.
It's,
but this is why, like you coming here and us having this conversation, the last hour or so that people have chosen to spend with us, hearing the personality in your voice, hearing the tone of your voice, news can't be told in 8 second chunks or 10 second chunks. Some shit takes, and we went all over the place today, some shit takes an hour.
Yeah.
To get even just the smallest amount of it. But that's what it is to be human, is to actually spend that amount of time. We want it to be quick. We want to look at a headline and go, I know the whole story, but that's not it.
Sorry.
Well, then she has chosen poorly.
Yeah, exactly. Actually, she that didn't work at all.
Would rather go, no.
That didn't work at all. Never mind.
Take your time, buddy.
This is actually something that I'm not really spoken about, but needs to be spoken about is that, like when I was named Australian of the Year, I was sort of like immediately co-opted oddly by the media as like an advocate for women. And it's not that I'm not an advocate for women by default, but that's not like, I was an advocate for survivors of child sexual abuse. And I made that very clear, but there was a convenience to that because it did actually close off. Well, you know, and again, like if you are not an advocate for women, then like, as far as I see it, like, you know, you should be an advocate for everyone or you're an idiot. Like, you know, you should advocate for human beings because we're all human.
Well, it's easy to say that you're an advocate for women versus an advocate for a childhood sexual abuse, because it's horrible to fucking speak about.
But that's why, because the media still, like the media, like child sexual abuse is the last frontier of discomfort for a lot of people. But I came out and I said that I was an advocate for survivors of child sexual abuse and that I wanted to prevent and respond to child sexual abuse. I said that very clearly in my speech. And then the media put a different label on me, but they also put a different label on me for, there's a sort of a different reason why they can do that. And that is because when you're a survivor of child abuse in whatever form, you are always a child to them. And so they can get away with treating you like a child and like you don't have your own agency to speak about or do what you want to do.
Right.
So there's this perpetual infantilization, which is ironic for a whole nother reason. And again, it's the same form of abuse. It's like, here, we are authoring your script again.
Yeah.
And that just kept happening, you know, because it's 1 in 5 boys and 1 in 3 girls. And I had to keep like saying that and justifying myself, which again is another like awful thing when you think about it, that I kept having to make my case and validate myself. And I felt like I wasn't believed and I felt like I wasn't being heard. And I was like, why are you doing this to me?
I'm glad you pointed that. Again, you've taught us a lot about the way that news media looks at people through describing your experience.
Because it's also a convenient way to set somebody up against their will, like when they didn't try to do it, to set somebody up to be someone who's going to cop criticism. Mm. Child sexual abuse is already divisive in of itself. Mm. You know, it's already scary for the reasons that I've explained in depth, because you get resistance from, you know, a subculture of child sex offenders who they network in packs. I mean,
it's beyond. Yeah. Well, look, I couldn't be happier that you came around. And thank you for being so generous with your time.
No worries.
You're the best, Grace.
No.